Hey folks, just about ready to start. Got a lot of stuff here, so I want to get started as soon as I can. How's everyone doing today? Woo! Ready? Okay, you are all in Game Design 101. This is specifically Board Game Design 101. My name's Gil Hova. I am a game designer, a board game designer. I've been doing this for a while. And I want to help save you some time, because it took me a while to figure out what was going on. And I hope that I can save some of you some time. So when I first started, I had no idea what I was doing. You know, I took what I thought were interesting themes. I tried to apply them to what I thought were interesting mechanisms. But the result was a hot mess, you know. Let me tell you about my very first game. My very first game modeled a paper, scissors, rock tournament, but the players were all psychic. I thought this was a really cool theme. It was terrible. There was just no gameplay. I have considered having this whole panel just dissecting what a terrible game it was, but instead I want to give the talk that I wish the me from 15 years ago had. So we're going to talk about the basics of good board game design. So here's a disclaimer. Obviously I'm a board game designer. If you're not a board game designer, this talk might still have a lot to do with you, especially the first half, but I can't guarantee that. So board games have real constraints that other forums don't have. The second half is pretty specific to board games. And I'm gonna be giving a lot of examples that are almost exclusively board games. So with that disclaimer out of the way, I have one more disclaimer. I'm going to assume that we're gonna be designing recreational games here as opposed to transformative games. Just because transformative games, you know, games that will somehow change you, are gonna be a whole different ball of wax. So here I'm assuming that we are going to be making games that people will want to replay because they enjoy them on some level, rather than games that somehow educate you or change you, which are valid and are really interesting games, but they're just a different approach. So, and they're not generally the approach I do. Okay, ready? Okay, so when I started designing games, this is what I thought I needed to do. I thought I needed to design for fun, which isn't wrong, but here's the problem with designing for fun. It's like a chef designing for tasty, like cooking for tasty. Like imagine you're gonna go out for dinner and you're like, where are we going? And your friends say, somewhere tasty. Well, okay, it's good, but is it Indian? Is it Mexican? Is it Italian? Is it Japanese? What if I'm in the mood for Thai or Ethiopian or I just want a good burger? We have all these words to describe food, and we have such a language to describe food. You know, we can describe nationality, but we can also describe sweet, spicy, savory, fattening, filling, lean, all of these words to describe food. So let's look at games. We have this one word to describe games, but it's not specific, you know? We have all these sensations and aesthetics that we can talk about. I mean, you can talk about Dead of Winter, Dominion, Jungle Speed, Twilight Imperium, Cards Against Humanity, and, you know, those games can all be described as fun, but they're so different. So this term, as designers, is not a useful term. So instead, we have to drill down, we have to be more specific. We have to use terms like interaction, balance, tension, screwage. We can describe genres like social deduction, or strategy, or thematic. We can describe specific mechanisms like worker placement, action drafting, I divide, you choose. As designers, we're obligated to be more specific than fun. So I'm gonna drill down into four specific terms, okay? And I think these are key terms for new game designers, and I frankly don't hear these terms a lot in board game design. The first two, I honestly rarely hear in board game design. I hear them a lot more in video game design. And the last two I hear a little more, but not as much as I think we should, okay? So I think we really should inject them into the lexicon, because the moment you're designing for these four terms, the moment you're gonna have a better idea of what you're doing. So in the first half, I'm really gonna talk about these things. I'm gonna talk about flow, I'm gonna talk about fiero, I'm gonna talk about heuristics, I'm gonna talk about core engagement. Now, you might be a designer with some experience, and you may not have heard of some of these terms, and that's okay, because not a lot of people talk about these terms. But I guarantee you that if you have some experience, you'll recognize what I'm talking about the moment I start talking. Even if you play games, you'll recognize these. So I think it's really valuable to put names on these experiences. So let's start with the first one, okay? So have you ever played a game and felt any of these? In the zone, addicted, oh my God, is that the sun rising? So if so, you've experienced flow, you know, and I think all of us have at one point. So this is actually a psychological concept that was named, I'm gonna butcher this name, here we go. Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi, I knew I'd screw this up. Csikszentmihalyi, that is his name. So he's a researcher who talked about how this mental state that he called flow, where people are fully engaged by a task, lose track of time, and are completely immersed and absorbed, okay? So that's the flow state. And if you've played a game, you're probably familiar with this flow state. Now, here's an important disclaimer. Flow is not exclusive to games, you know? Flow is not just a game design term, okay? There are many, many tasks that put people, non-gamers, into flow state. I mean, how many of you are computer programmers? We're at a game convention. There's got to be a few computer programmers here. I'm sure you've experienced flow. You know, you get lost in the task, you know, because computer programming is really good at putting us into flow for reasons you're going to see shortly. Surgeons experience flow. Craftsmen experience flow. Anyone who gets engaged with their work experiences flow. So it's not that flow is exclusive to games, but it just so happens that games are amazing at generating flow. So how do we get flow in our games? There's really three things as game designers that we need to incorporate and make sure are in our games to invoke flow in our players. So the list I'm going to show you, these three things are not a comprehensive list of flow. I'm not a psychologist. I can't tell you all about flow, but I can tell you how flow integrates with games, okay? And I can tell you how we have control over it as game designers. So the first thing is we need a clear set of goals to work towards, okay? Doesn't have to be the object of the game, and I think a great example of this, and one thing that makes this such a great game, Ticket to Ride. So first off, you have the ticket cards. Very clearly, these are goals you are working for. There are cards in your hand that you are working towards. But not only do we have the tickets, we have the routes. And you have to build up for the routes as well. So you have these mid-game goals, as well as these tickets that function as end-game goals. So you're gonna collect cards, and you're gonna collect cards, and the cards you're collecting are not arbitrary. You know, you're working towards filling specific routes. And at some point, you're gonna have enough routes to claim that route. Enough cards to claim that route, excuse me. So you haven't won the game when you claim the route, but you had a clear goal, and you knew what you had to do to work towards that goal. So that's the first thing that gets you into a flow state. The second thing is you get immediate feedback on your actions in relationship to the goal. So every time you draw a card, you know you're one step closer to finishing that route. It's not like the color of the route changes. It's not like you have to swap hands with a player on your left. You know when you draw that card, you're a step closer. So that is a really important element of flow. And the third part is that the goal can't be too easy or too hard. And this part's the toughest to get right. If you make the goal too hard, then the game's frustrating. You know, so you see this axis? You want to be, let me not trip over myself. I don't want to be tripping over myself. You want to be in the middle, right here. If you're up here, you're too frustrating. If you're down here, you're too boring. So if you're too hard, people are gonna be like, This is terrible, this game's frustrating, I can't do what I want, I quit, flip the table. And if you're down here, it's just, well, I roll the die again, this is boring, you know? And the challenge is it's a moving target, you know? People will keep playing your game, and they're gonna get more and more experienced in the game. But you have to keep them in that flow channel. Even within a single game, as they start getting familiar with the game, maybe what's interesting on turn one won't necessarily be interesting in turn five. So you have to keep them in this flow channel, you know? So how do you accommodate that? We're gonna get to it, I promise. But this is one of the things you have to keep in mind, is keeping people in flow and keeping them engaged in that experience. So here's the next part, and this is such an interesting, you know, yang to flows yin, is, and I may have gotten that backwards, please excuse me, but this is such an important counterbalance that all recreational games need, and it's called fiero. Jane McGonigal talks about fiero a lot, and that's her right there. She's a great game designer, mainly works with augmented reality games, but she has some really great concepts that have helped me a lot. She defines fiero as that moment of triumph where you throw your arms over your head. It doesn't necessarily mean winning. It just means you've done something amazing. Like maybe you do claim that route, not even that ticket, but that route just before the player to your left was going to claim it. And they go, oh no. And you're like, yes, I got it. I got it just before you did, you know? And that's fiero. Fiero is a counterbalance to flow. So flow's like this long-term atemporal feeling. Like the whole idea behind flow is you just lose track of time. But fiero is this one fleeting ephemeral moment. Like it's very fixed in a moment in time, you know? Fiero, bang, you feel it. And it's so you punctuate flow with moments of fiero. And the balance of these two concepts is vital in any game. This is not just board games now, but any recreational game, RPG, video game, has to have a good balance of flow and fiero. And when you get to, like, you know, the real big league video game designers, they have percentages. They're like, okay, we want 40% fiero moments and 60% flow, you know? And it's really fascinating how, like, these at those really high levels, you get to see such psychology in game design. But this is tricky because you might have a game where a player never experiences fiero, you know? But it's that taste of that potential, that possibility of getting it that's important. And if you can have every player at least feel good about what they've done, you have the potential for good fiero. Now, there's deeper considerations here. You know, you've got runaway leaders, you've got fallaway trailers. You can have a game that's too well balanced, and if everybody experiences fiero and every game results in a tie, there's a problem with your game because the game should reflect how the players are. And if one player does really well, much better than the others, the game should be a blowout. It should. You know, not every game that you play should be close because it's got to reflect how the players did. But the takeaway here is that we have to design for these fiero moments. We have to have these moments where players feel amazing. And that's so important in what we do. So now we've got these two vital terms out of the way, flow and fiero. Let's talk about what we're actually trying to do when we design a game. So here's another disclaimer. I'm sidestepping a lot of really fascinating discussions. I'm trying to get to sort of the meat of what I think a first-time designer needs to know about board game design theory, but there's some amazing questions here, like what is a game? Like how do you define a game? It's such a really amazing question. What is play? Like how do play and game link up? Like play is something you could put into a master's thesis. Like it is a deep subject. Can you have a game without play? You know, these are really important questions, but this is a 101 seminar, and we're not going to get into those. I want to approach this talk to someone like me 15 years ago. I just have my game about psychic paper, scissors, rock players, and I want to make it. So how do I do it? Well, I don't have the basic resources. We can get into philosophy maybe at a future seminar, talking about things like social contracts, cultural impact of play. You know, these are all fascinating subjects, but right now I want to give the basic tools. So like this, what are we trying to do as game designers? What's our job as game designers? So I can summarize this actually in three words, and I think these three words I'm going to give you are the most crucial of any game designer. If you're ever lost, these three words are going to be your light. Incentivize interesting behavior. When all else fails, as game designers, we want to incentivize interesting behavior. So what does that mean? It means we as game designers should always be incentivizing players to stay in a flow state. And we always need to incentivize them into fiero moments. That's what we do as game designers. Game design is creative incentivization. Let me repeat that. Game design is creative incentivization. We are trying to get players to engage in specific behavior that will help them experience flow and fiero. As a result, any behavior that pulls players out of the zone or cancels one player's fiero without generating a bigger fiero for the other players, that's a behavior that the game should actively discourage. So, how many people know about Luke Crane and Jared Sorensen? They're role-playing game designers, really smart people. They have a seminar of their own called Game Design is Mind Control. And it's specifically about incentivization and about how a good game designer will set incentives for their games to get players to do things that they wouldn't otherwise do. And again, that's all incentivization. We're incentivizing people to sit around a table and move cardboard for an hour or two. I mean, that's weird, right? That's really strange. But we have to provide them such great incentives that not only will they do it, they're going to do it again. So you can search for the seminar online, Game Design is Mind Control. One of my favorite moments of the seminar was when Luke challenged Jared to a race. He said, race you to a chair and back. And Jared said, okay. And then Luke held Jared back and kept him from getting to the chair. So that's a great example of a game with bad incentives. You know, in that example, the incentive to hold Jared back was just as strong as the incentive to get to the chair. And in this context, holding Jared back, regardless of how you feel about Jared, is not interesting from the perspective of the game. It's unlikely you're going to encounter flow in that particular kind of race because there's no specific goal related to holding Jared back. How long do you hold Jared back? It's just kind of boring after a while. It's not interesting. So to avoid those kinds of things, a real race, what does a real race have?
Finish.
Not just a finish, to keep someone from holding the other player back. It has what?
Rules.
Not just rules, what do the rules have? Nope, specifically in a race. Thinking about like a 100 meter dash. You've got like Usain Bolt. You know, the gun goes off, what keeps Usain Bolt from challenging? And what's in the track?
Lanes,
exactly. The lanes disincentivize players because if you stray out of the lane, you're out of the race. You cannot mess with another player in a race like that. So because of that, the game of the race is interesting because all we're interested in is who's the fastest. We don't care who can tackle. That's a different kind of sport. So in that respect, racers act exactly as we want them to because we have set up the rules to this race to properly incentivize the runners. And you think about it, cultures all over the world have races like this and they all have that rule. You know, you can't mess with the other race unless you're talking about some specific sport, but then it's no longer really racing. So now you got these incentives and we now know we have to incentivize interesting behavior. And we have these states of flow and fiero and we have this methodology to achieve flow and fiero through incentivizing interesting behavior. So how do we do that? We do that with mainly with heuristics to me. There's a few ways, but one of the most powerful is to understand heuristics and how players are using or are not using your in-game heuristics. So this is an intimidating word. You know, it sounds like I'm about to go into computer science, but this is a really simple subject. A heuristic is a rule of thumb that a player uses to guide their actions within a game. I'll repeat that a little bit slower. I went a little fast there. A heuristic is a rule of thumb that a player uses to guide their actions within a game. As a designer, you need to be on top of what heuristics your players are adopting. You need to make sure those heuristics reinforce the behavior you're looking for your players to perform. So let's look at one of the simplest games of all. So what is the heuristic that a tic-tac-toe player will use? What's a rule of thumb that they're going to use?
Middle square.
That's right. That's a fantastic example of a heuristic. It's not a game rule. There's nothing in the rules of tic-tac-toe that says take the middle square, but it's a heuristic. And once you master it, you know how helpful it is. Once you've played a few games, you know how helpful that middle square is. Let's look at another game, poker. What's a heuristic for poker?
High cards are good.
That's a good heuristic. What's another one?
Just vote on your
hands. I'm not sure how well you do at poker. What's another heuristic? That's a good heuristic.
Poker face.
That's leading to a heuristic that I find really interesting.
Bluffing.
Bingo. Specifically, raise with a poor hand to intimidate your opponents. That is a heuristic. And that illustrates a vital point about heuristics. Now, think about one of the most iconic things about poker is bluffing. Like, that is one of the central tenets of the game. But it's not a rule. Like, in none of the forms of poker, Texas Hold'em or draw, nothing says anything about bluffing. Nothing says you can bluff. And yet, that's one of the most identifiable characteristics about poker. You take out bluffing from poker and it's not really poker anymore. It's one of the central characteristics of the game and it's not mentioned in the rules anywhere. That speaks to the power of heuristics and how much they can define a game. So your game will not necessarily be defined by its rules. So I think this is worth a really interesting tangent. Gaming is, in a way, holography. So stay with me here. I'm going to take you through the holographic principle of gaming, of game design. So you're all familiar with holograms, right? Believe me, in the 80s, that they were right up there with lasers in terms of future stuff. Like, the future was all going to be lasers and holograms, and then we got distracted by chaos theory and fractals, but I'm drifting. So with a hologram, you've got this piece of two-dimensional film, and then you shine a laser through it at the right angle, and suddenly a 3D image emerges. That 3D image isn't part of the film. It only emerges under the correct circumstances. If you're going to make a hologram, you don't make a 3D image. You don't directly make that 3D image. You make the 2D image on film and then project it. So there's this step of detachment that when you're making a hologram, you don't make the image. You make the film through which the image is projected, from which the image is projected. So games are the same way. Like, we as game designers cannot directly manipulate the game experience, right? Like, we can't tell players through the rule book to smile as they play the game. We can't tell players have a lot of fun. Like, we can't do that. We can't tell players, oh, by the way, bluff here. Like, we can't tell them to roll the dice with their left hand. Like, we can, but they won't necessarily do it. We can't tell them to switch positions every three turns unless we incentivize them through the rules of the game. All we can do is manipulate the rules and the presentation details of the game. And then, like the hologram, the game experience emerges. It almost fills the negative space that the rule set forms. So we can manipulate the rules, we can mess around with the art of the game and the bits that we use. We as game designers have control over that. But in order to change anything from the gameplay experience, from the director's perspective, we're limited to this flat surface of just the rules and components. And then we see how the changes we make affect the gameplay experience. So, to get back, to tell you like how that relates, let's start talking about zero-level heuristics, okay? These are the first heuristics that a player will grasp for when they're learning a game. And this is a good way to talk about them, because we've all been in this situation, right? Somebody explains, we sit down to play a game that we've never played before. Somebody explains the rules, comes around to your first turn, people say, okay, what you gonna do? And I have no idea. You have absolutely no idea what you need to do. And sometimes you even understand the rules of the game, you just have no idea how to win. Like, what do I do? Do I do A or B? I have no idea. How many people have been in that situation with a game? Oh, yeah, absolutely. Very common. That speaks to a lack of zero-level heuristics. And you know, anyone familiar with the board game scene knows, the bar is really, really high. Like, a game has to be pretty much perfect for it to even last a few months in the market. If you don't blow your players away in the first game, they're not coming back. You know, there's no reason for them to ever play your game again. So these zero-level heuristics are especially crucial these days, because players will judge your game like that. They're going to judge your game right away. So what causes a lack of zero-level heuristics? Can anyone guess what causes a lack of zero-level heuristics?
Lack of incentives.
Lack of incentives. That's exactly right. It goes back to interest in incentivizing interesting behavior. Heuristics should line right up with the interesting behavior of your game. Your players' heuristics should always be interesting to act out. Players should always be looking forward to their next turn because they're about to do this really cool thing. So when a game has no zero-level heuristics, that means it has no distinguishable early game incentives. There's no reason to move left instead of right, because as far as the player's concerned, they're both equal. And if we go back to flow, remember one of the conditions of flow was immediate feedback to how far you are from your goal. So if you don't know your goal, you don't know how far or close your move just is going to take you, then the game experience is going to be foggy. So the best games make it clear from the beginning what actions are the most interesting. They may not be optimal, but they'll be clear, and that's good enough for a first-time player. So let's take a real-life example. Let's look at a game with really good zero-level heuristics. King of Tokyo. How many people have played King of Tokyo? Awesome. What's the cool, interesting thing you can do in King of Tokyo? What is it? The cool, interesting thing.
Go to Manhattan.
That's right. Well, Manhattan or Tokyo. Yeah, if you're playing King of New York, go to Manhattan. So attack the city, you know? So that game, whose designer might know a thing or two about incentives and heuristics, that game incentivizes players to enter the city, and that's clear right from the start. This is how you get most of your points. Attack the city, you're going to get a ton of points. You may not win the game, but that's the interesting thing to do, and everybody wants to do it. So this is a great zero-level heuristic. You know, attack Tokyo. Just don't apply it to other games. Like, don't play Bonanza and say, I attack Tokyo. Doesn't work that well. So let's talk about this weird phrase, climbing the heuristic tree, okay? This refers to the process, once players have mastered the zero-level heuristics, they're going to start to get better. In other words, they're going to start forming a chain of heuristics. They're going to get better heuristics and better heuristics. They're going to discover these new rules of thumb. And as they get better, they advance in skill, and we call that climbing the heuristic tree. So as players get better, they just... Oh, by the way, I have to credit this to the book Characteristics of Games. Has a chapter on heuristics that's absolutely phenomenal. So I suggest it. Characteristics of Games is the name of the book. So as players get better, sorry? I'm blanking, I'm sorry. as players get better, they're gonna discover more advanced heuristics. Make no mistake, this is the process, this process of discovering the more powerful heuristics, climbing the heuristic tree, this is one of the most powerful and compelling parts of enjoying games. For a lot of players, this is the fun of gaming. Like, this is why they game, is to climb the heuristic tree and to get better and better and find new and more sophisticated ways to play. So let's talk about chess's heuristic tree, okay? Now, disclaimer, I am a complete idiot at chess. I know how to play, I play really poorly. So this tree over here, this is a sequoia tree. This is one of those huge, huge trees in California. Those little white things on the bottom, those are people. You know, so these are the trees that you drive a car through the trunk. So, like, there's a tunnel in the trunk, and the tree's still alive because there's just so much tree. So, when you first learn to play chess, you'll be at the bottom of the heuristic tree. You know, these are the heuristics you'll have. A new player might just, like, recklessly try to capture their opponent's pieces. And then, when they leave their king open for checkmate in their first game, they'll learn it's important. The next heuristic is important, protect your king. So they'll try to balance those two heuristics, and the next time they play, they'll get better. Then maybe at some point, they learn the power of the middle four spaces of the board, and they get better. They get another heuristic, control the middle of the board. And then they start learning about material and the point values of the pieces. And again, point values, it's not like, yeah, I capture a bishop, I get 5 points. I don't remember the point value. Like I said, I'm a terrible chess player. But it's so important for heuristics to just not lose points when you make that exchange. And you get even better. They're climbing higher and higher on that heuristic tree. And then at some point, you're studying the King's Gambit or the Sicilian Defense, and you're often running in the world of chess study. So heuristics isn't just the study of the openings and defenses, it's the knowledge of where to apply them. Then you learn about pawn formations, and from there, you know, who knows, you know, a match with Garry Kasparov, or at least one of those chess fanatics in Washington Square Park. You know, it's something. It's just, this is how you do it. You climb this tree. But this process of climbing the heuristic tree in chess shows how deep chess is. And that applies to any deep game that rewards study. And there's a few of them. We call them lifestyle games. Like Go, Poker, Bridge, even Magic or the 18XX series of games, those have enormous heuristic trees. And that appeals to a lot of people. You know, there's always another level to master, okay? So this metaphor explains why there's so many more people who play chess than tic-tac-toe. So let's talk about tic-tac-toe's heuristic tree. So tic-tac-toe doesn't really have a heuristic tree. It has a heuristic bush. You learn this one principle, control the middle square, and then that's it. Once you get to that level, there's nothing past there. Tic-tac-toe does not reward further study past control the middle square. There's no advancing or progressing. So there's really nothing to talk about here, which is why nobody really talks about tic-tac-toe, except in seminars like this where we talk about why tic-tac-toe is not the kind of game you want to design. So we're going to talk about an unfortunate heuristic tree to one of my favorite games. So we're going to talk about the heuristic tree to Terra Mystica, which is a game I love and adore. But its heuristic tree looks like this. Okay? It's a palm tree. Because how do you climb a palm tree? I mean, it's not easy. And when I teach Terra Mystica, about 15, 20 minutes into the explanation, I see people's eyes start to glaze over. Because its rules are so tightly coupled, there's no, like, let's just play. Like, you have to know how shovels work. You have to know what your buildings do. You have to know how power works. You have to know how the cult track works. You have to know how the favor tokens fit in. I haven't even mentioned towns or adjacency power bonus or indirect adjacencies or racial bonuses. So that explains this palm tree. You know, it's a beautiful tree. And Terra Mystica is a great game, but there's no low branches to climb. So your first turn is like, I just have to take everything I just heard in the past 30 minutes and synthesize it into a move, and it's really hard. Now, Terra Mystica can get away with it because it is an amazing game, but you have to be really, really careful about making a game with this kind of heuristic tree. You're gonna really limit your audience. So, some of the stuff might sound familiar. We're talking about not too easy for tic-tac-toe, not too hard about Terra Mystica, and that sounds familiar, doesn't it? It's like that flow state diagram before. Remember how I mentioned that I get back to this about keeping gamers in flow despite rising difficulty? This is how you do it, by paying attention to the heuristic tree. So this diagram I'm using a little bit differently. Instead of talking about like one game session, I'm talking about coming back to the game over and over. But the underlying concept's exactly the same, you know? So we've got your heuristic bush right down here, you know? Maybe the first game is super easy, but you get bored. And then the palm tree's right up here. That first game is really hard, but if you stick through it, you hit that climbable heuristic tree. But ideally, you want to be right in the middle. You want to be in this channel in the middle, have a nice branch early to grasp on, like, oh, this is what I can do on my first turn. May not be an optimal move, but it's a move, and it's a move that I know is going to be interesting and is going to produce some, it's going to be an interesting turnout. And you're going to find that players are more likely to come back to your game if you have this heuristic tree. And this takes us to our final topic for the first half of this talk, and this is a real biggie, core engagement. Okay? And it's unfortunate that I put this last, because this to me is one of the most important concepts in game design. But to get to the subject, I really need to go through flow, fiero, and heuristics. So core engagement is the central core of your game that appeals to players. Like, for example, let's take Dominion. What's the core of Dominion? What gets people to play Dominion? Deck building, exactly. The core of the game is just watching your deck grow from the Spartan, you know, it's like 7 copper and 3 the 1 point cards, you know? But it goes from that to this really crazy deck, or maybe it's this really thin deck with a few really powerful cards. Either way, your deck is gonna get really, really powerful. Now, Arkham Horror's core engagement is a little different. Its core engagement is, I think it's the emergent narrative of the battle against the great old ones, and that struggle to close the gate. And that's so much more narrative and thematic, you know? It's so much more direct, like it feels like you're part of the world. Now let's look at Jungle Speed. I'll give it back to you. What's Jungle Speed's core engagement? Speed, grabbing that totem, that tactile twitch nature. You know? So all these games serve their core engagement really well, but their core engagements are all wildly different. Like, these are all games, but they're such different games. So imagine, so these games all, what they do have in common is they serve the core engagement really, really well. So imagine in Dominion, after you play a card, you trash it and replace it with a copper. That'd be awful, right? You know, you just work, because it works against the game's core engagement. The rules in that game all serve the core engagement of building your deck. Now imagine in Arkham Horror, imagine you didn't have a player pawn. Imagine instead every turn there was an auction where you could bid for influence in 5 different areas and slowly work your influence up in 5 different areas. That to me sounds really dull, you know? Not that auctions are dull, but for Arkham Horror, that just because it works against the game's core engagement. As a thematic game, your character's presence needs to be registered on the board. You want to be in the game because you take up space in that world. And if you're not careful, you could be swept away into a different world. Now, Jungle Speed, imagine instead of grabbing the totem, When you saw a match, you rolled a die, and the first player to roll a six gets to get rid of their discard pile. You know, again, you're like losing the core engagement. So those three awful tweaks are example of tweaks that work against your game's core engagement. So when I design a game, one of the first things I look at is, what do I want the game's core engagement to be? Now, I don't have to have it the first time I have the prototype, but those first few tests, I'm looking really hard at it. And it's really common to discover a few tests in that your game's core engagement is actually completely different. Like, you might think your game's core engagement is over here, but the player's all like this. And if you're paying attention, you'll be like, okay, I'm gonna get rid of all this stuff. I'm gonna focus on this, because this is what my players really want. So it's so common to ditch your old core engagement and build up your new core engagement. So Dan, I saw you around here. Are you here, Dan? Hey, can I talk about Enemy and Enemy? That, because I really love this game. So Dan has this awesome game called Enemy and Enemy, except that I'm blanking, and I'm going to talk about it later. I'm sorry. I'm going to talk about another friend's game. Sorry about that. Blanking. So another friend of mine has this party game where you're coming up with a movie script based on cues, the cards that other people give you. So it's like a pitching party game, okay? And I was one of the playtesters, and coming up with the scripts was so much fun. You know, telling the story, like making up this movie, was a lot of fun. But he also had this mechanism where after each pitch, you had these money cards, and you gave players money cards. The higher the money card, the more you liked the pitch. But you had a hand of them, like you didn't have all of them at once. And if you got a bunch of low ones, you could give a player a low one just to mess with them. And you gave them the votes, the money cards, after each pitch, not after you heard all the pitches. So one player would pitch, and he said, well, one thing you'd do is just give them a low card. I'm like, what if they had a good pitch? Well, you know, then give them a high card, but you could give them a low card. He's like, it's tactical. And you see the problem here, that the core engagement of the game is telling the story. The fun of the game is coming up with the film script. And then you have this other mechanism where maybe there's this take that, screw you thing where you're giving a player low cards, but it works against telling the stories because you're not incentivizing the player to tell the stories. So with the vocabulary, with our new vocabulary, you see what's going wrong. We never entered a flow state, because we told this awesome story, and then we had to do this mechanical thing that had nothing to do with what we just did. So that pulled us out. And there was no fiero moments either, because you could tell this awesome story and then just get a bunch of low cards just because. So one of the suggestions was just try it as a traditional pitching game. You know, you pitch a script, then the next player pitches, then the next player pitches, and then you vote. And everybody has the same hand. You don't have this random hand anymore. And, you know, it worked like other pitching games, but it was so much fun. And it had this distinct identity, because there aren't many other pitching games where you're making a movie. You know, and it connected like a circuit, you know? It's like that circuit closed. And then we talked about ways to start distinguishing on the market and making it different than other pitching games. But we had to get past this hurdle that we had this mechanism that wasn't serving the game's core engagement. And once we ditched that part, the game really started taking off. It also helped the game heuristically, you know, because we had these two competing heuristics. We had tell a good story, and we had play low cards on each other, you know? And there are heuristics that just, they didn't really relate to each other, you know? They felt, something felt off. Once we ditched the play low cards heuristic, the tell a good story heuristic really shined. Not much climbing to do, sure, but maybe there's like little tricks that you learn in a pitching game, like this is a good thing to do, like, oh, this is a card about polar bears, and I have a good story about polar bears, you know? So a game isn't really judged by how innovative it is or how many mechanisms it has. I mean, those are all things people key off of, but we get back to this vocabulary. You know, good vocabulary is how easily a player gets into the flow state, how much fiero a player feels, how climbable its heuristic tree is, and how well it serves its core engagement. You know, these are all things that I think really tell you what a good game does. So we're getting to the end of the first half over here, and so we get back to why the term fun is so useless to us as game designers. I just spent 40 minutes talking about fun, but I think I used it maybe once, you know, because we talk about how a game is fun. Flow, fiero, heuristics, and core engagement. Okay? I've got some other things to talk about, but does anybody have any questions right now? Yeah? Flip the Script by Clint Miller.
Awesome.
And hopefully coming out soon. And it's a great game. I love it. Really love it. Any other questions? Okay, I got a few other things to talk about. And one thing, this is the more practical half that I'm going to get into. Still some theoretical stuff, but this is the more practical side. So let's talk a bit about theme and mechanism, because new designers usually get hung up a bit on theme and mechanism. And part of the reason is I hear one question a lot, like people ask, so what do you start with, theme first or mechanism first? And it doesn't matter, you know? I don't think it matters whether you start with theme or whether it starts with, you start with mechanism. Kinesius says that for a while he started with theme, then he started with mechanism, then he moved back to theme, and he went back and forth because he wanted to keep challenging himself. They're both valid. Now, personally, I find starting with a mechanism harder than starting with a theme, but that doesn't make it any less valid, and it doesn't mean that all games that start with mechanism are worse. The important thing, the vital thing, is where they meet. You want your theme and mechanism to meet. You know, you want the theme to serve a purpose, and all themes serve a purpose. To me, there's no such thing as a pasted-on theme. Like, people say, oh, this theme's pasted-on. Well, let's do this a little exercise. Let's do a little exercise. I've got a game, and the theme's about pirates. How do we play the game? What are the mechanisms?
You're gonna steal,
because pirates steal. Yep.
You're gonna sail,
because pirates sail. Yeah. But you see, I said one word, and now we're already talking about the mechanisms of the game. Now we've got another game. We got a game about building a castle. Tell me what mechanisms are in this game about building a castle.
Gathering stone,
that's right. Maybe we'd gather some wood as well. Maybe there'd be a pig or two. You're managing your workers.
Yeah.
But you see how, you know, this theme, and if generally, you know, I've got a game about building a castle, the first thing people are going to say, oh, it's a pasted on theme. But we just proved that it's not. We just derived mechanism from the theme. That castle theme has a purpose, because it says this is what this game's about. This game's about gathering resources. And that is vital, you know? So your game lives. That heart of your game is going to beat at the intersection of your theme and mechanism. That's where your story's emerging. You have to be cognizant of that joint. So if you have a game about managing resources, like about gathering stuff and, you know, putting things together, but your theme is about elementary school kids holding an illicit dog show at school and trying to train and show the best dogs without getting caught, you have a problem, you know? That's a mismatch, because I'm going to say, I've got this great theme about high school kids holding a dog show, and you sit down, the game's about gathering resources. So you see the problem here, you know? Now, the game might still work. You know, you might still get people to sit down and play the game, and they might enjoy the game. But there's a cognitive dissonance there, you know? People will sit down and expect one kind of game. They're like, okay, well, this is going to be like a 15-minute take that game, right? Wait, what are all these bits? So if you have a game, another example, if you have a game where the protagonists are all kids, and you've got like cartoony kid art, and the game turns out to be a two-hour strategy game, you've got a mismatch, you know? And the reason I'm talking about this is, of course, I found about this the hard way. So I had a game design called Pax Robotica. And the game was about building and selling war robots. And I'd tell people, hey, do you want to play my game about building and selling war robots? And they said, sure, I'll play your game about war robots. And you see the difference. So they sat down to play a game about fighting robots, and they got this spreadsheet game. And it didn't work, you know? Well, it worked. Eventually, they got into it. But the first few rounds were like, huh? I changed the theme. Maybe you know the game's now Battle Merchants, and it came out last year. And it's now a fantasy theme. And now there's four fantasy races at war, and you're building swords. Why am I blanking on this? This is my game. Swords, hammers, axes, and maces. Thank you, someone who's played the game. So the problem can be, so let's go back to like that dog show game, that high school dog show game. People who'd be interested in that game might be like high school students, parents of high school students. People who would actually enjoy the game are people who like heavier resource management games. So those people are gonna pick up the box and see, oh, high school dog show, put it right back down. They're not going to be interested. The people who are going to be interested in the game, the people who will pick it up and be like, oh, high school, I got this game about high school dog show. Here's the rule book. You know, and, you know, right away you've got a problem. So you don't want to alienate the audience that your mechanism should appeal to, along with the audience that the theme is pulling in. You know, you need that theme and mechanism to intersect properly, okay? And that's something to keep an eye on with your game. So there's also a perspective thing here. So players approach the theme mechanism join from a different perspective. Dan, this is where I'm pulling you in. So you gotta switch that perspective around, and it goes back to the hologram, you know? Your players see the image, but we as the game designers can only manipulate the film. So sometimes we get carried away with that, you know, and we see the theme on the film and we think that's how players are going to experience it. So let's go back to Kinesia. Ra. Did you know that, how many of you played Ra? Auction game? One of the best auction games out there. Fantastic auction game. So how thematic is Ra?
Middle low, I'd say.
It's fair. Very fair. I mean, on one hand, the theme could be about anything, yet, you know, the Egyptian theme sort of warns us that this could be a very dry game.
It's not tacked on, but it's not absolutely.
Exactly. How many of you played Euphoria, the Jamie Stegmaier game? How thematic is that game? Do you feel like you're in a dystopia?
Yeah.
Do you?
Yeah, I do.
I feel like I'm manipulating a spreadsheet in that game. I don't think it's a bad game. You know, I think it's a good game. But I, you know, that's one we could agree to disagree there. But so let's focus on Ra. So, Kinesia started with a theme with Ra. That was the theme first game. You know, Kinesia said, "I'm gonna make a game about the three Egyptian kingdoms," and he wound up with this game that turned out to not really be all that thematic. And that happens when you're looking at the theme from a designer's point of view, and the theme mechanism integration. I have this game in my collection called Monkeys on the Moon, and the game is about civilizing tribes of monkeys living on the moon and then shooting them back to Earth. And it's a fantastic game, but it's a bidding euro. It's a bidding, you sit down and play the game, you're expecting this ha-ha silly fun game. It is a dry bidding euro. Fantastic game, but it should have been about trading in the Mediterranean. As much as I hate to say it, that theme would have warned us that this is a dry bidding game. And again, those themes are not pasted on. Those themes serve a purpose. And Monkeys on the Moon struggled because people did not get the game they expected. So, Dan, I'm going to bring your game in because I love your game, Enemy and Enemy. First off, it's got an awesome name, and I actually pronounced it. But so it's a card game. The players are all different sea creatures. And so there is this one sea creature that was an octopus, and the octopus started with 8 cards in their hand instead of 5. And there's another creature, the whale, where you could play, I think it was you could play 2 cards instead of 1. Am I right, Dan?
Play 1, you can add a subtract 1.
That's right, yeah, yeah. So, and we played it, and it was it's a great game. It's a really fun game. But I remember feeling that the octopus didn't feel like an octopus because he had 8 cards. The octopus felt like a whale. You know, because you had so many cards, you felt like this huge creature. And the whale didn't really feel like a whale. And this isn't to single Dan out, because I think Dan's a tremendous designer. I think you're awesome. Because, God, I've been through the stuff, you know? I've been through this horrible theme mechanism stuff. But my suggestion was make the whale, I think we suggested bringing it up to like 10 cards, and make the octopus so that you can grab cards that are on the table. Like your tentacle goes out and sucks them in. And, you know, that's an example of like 8 cards for the octopus seems like it's thematic at first, but that's sort of looking at it from the holographic film and not at the actual image. And once you actually see it on the image, it's much better. One of my tips about doing this and making sure your theme is emerging from your mechanism, here's one tip. Remove as much flavor text as you can from your game, from your game cards. I'm serious. Take as much flavor text out. So if you have like this paragraph on each card, remove it. Leave the title in, leave the art in, but take any other flavor text out. Players should feel like the card is the card. Like if you have a Space Pirates card, it should feel like you're being attacked by Space Pirates. It shouldn't feel like you're discarding a card. It should feel like, oh, these are the Space Pirates attacking me. You know, it shouldn't say, yar, shiver me timbers. That should be coming from the players, not the card. So that's one of my tips for getting that to come out. So we have about 10 minutes left, and I think we're going to finish on time. So let me talk about my four stages of playtesting, because I can't do a 101 seminar without talking about playtesting. Playtesting to me is game design, or at least it's like 90% of game design is playtesting. So testing to me is vital. I mean, that is where everything happens. And a lot of new designers think coming up with a game design is thinking a lot in the shower and writing down in your notebook, and they think that's game design. No, game design is playtesting. It's testing and testing and testing and refining and refining and refining. And I found that my games go through four stages. So my first stage is a proof of concept, and my game is hideous. It's like scrawled out on pieces of paper. My handwriting is atrocious, you know. I remember someone looking at my handwriting once and saying, is that code? You know? But at this point, you have a hideous prototype. I don't worry about graphics. They're literally on, like, maybe even like pages ripped from a spiral notebook, you know? I don't even care about balance at this point. The only thing I'm asking is this a game? Or I guess I'm asking more things. Is this a game? Where is the game? What is the core engagement? I want to get this game to the table as quickly as possible. If I can, I want to play it with other designers, because this game is going to be awful. You know, it's going to break. And if I bring it to my game group, they're never going to want to play another one of my prototypes again. Like, I want to play this with either really, really good friends who will forgive me, or with game designers who know the process. So after a while, I might have my, okay, I think I know that this is the game's core engagement. I think I have an idea. Now I make a plain prototype. You know, so now it's like text, maybe a couple of icons, but not much. I'm not spending much time on the look of the game here. I'm just making it look as clean as possible. And I have an alpha prototype. And at this point, I'm asking, do I have the correct core engagement? Because, again, the core engagement might be in a totally different place than what I'm expecting. If I do have it, how do I better serve it? Are all my mechanisms serving the core engagement? Is there one mechanism that's not there? Is the general balance, I'm putting that in quotes, okay. And that's not specific balance. I'm not looking at different strategies. Just, is general balance okay? Are all the actions interesting? Are there any actions that are uninteresting? And again, we talked about incentivizing interesting behavior. That's the lens we're looking at that through. Are there any other cool things that players want to do? And here I'm still playing with designers because the game is still really ugly, and some dedicated gamers. The game's probably still going to break a lot because I'm trying a lot of radical things. Like, you know, every other playtest, I'm like, okay, I'm trying this new thing, and two rounds later it breaks. And that's fine. At this point, if you only make it a few rounds in your game and you call it, that's fine. That doesn't mean your game is irreparably damaged, you know? It just means that, okay, let's try something else. I mean, iteration should be really quick, and don't be afraid to fail. Fail fast, as they say. Then we get a beta, you know, the functional prototype. Like, is the game balance fair? And I'm putting balance in quotes because your game might necessarily have to be balanced. It might not necessarily have to be balanced. It might be like a Carl Chudik game where it's just powers are crazy, cosmic encounter, things are going all over, and it's sort of up to the players to balance. Balance can be boring, you know? So it really depends on your game. If you have the kind of game that doesn't need to be balanced, don't, you know, just look and just make sure that players don't feel ripped off playing it. Make sure they feel like it's fun. Are there any, at this point, this is where I start worrying about broken strategies. Like, are there any degenerate strategies? You'll notice that first two, I didn't really care about degenerate strategies there. Now I'm starting to worry about that, you know? Do the scores reflect how the game actually went? And again, if your game always results in a close game, that's not a good thing. Like, if one player is doing really, really well, that player should win in a blowout. If one player does really, really poorly, they should be really far behind. And that sounds cruel, but it accurately reflects how the game went. Is the game missing anything? And at this point, I'm bringing the game to game groups, you know? And I'm starting marketing. I'm starting to tweet about the game at this point. And that's a weird thing to talk about, but this is the reality. In 2015, especially if you're like a solo game designer, freelance game designer, this is a good point to start talking about your game, because this point things are stable. In that proof of concept step, I'm not telling anybody anything about the game. Not because I'm worried about theft or stealing ideas. I don't want to say this game is a cool auction, and the next playtest, oh, okay, I'm going to get rid of the auction. You know, everything is volatile. So in the beta, it's stable enough that, okay, I can start talking about the game. Then the gamma, you know, the gamma test, generally you're going to do this test, if you're a freelance designer, you're going to do this test once you sign the game. You know, at this point, you're testing the graphics. So some people like worry about the graphics. I have one guy in my group, the first thing he always says is, your game looks really good or your game looks really bad. And I'm like, even if I'm in the proof of concept step, I don't care. You know, that's not important. But in the gamma step, that's crucial. That's where I'm asking, are the graphics good? Is the presentation good? Are there confusing or misleading icons? Is the graphic design colorblind friendly? Oh, that's important. Colorblind friendliness is crucial, but I'd say don't worry about it till gamma, you know? Unless you have colorblind playtesters, you know, then as a favor to them, worry about that in alpha or beta. You know, get to it, but to me, during alpha or beta, you're answering bigger questions, you know? Unless your game somehow hinges on color and there's something vital about the color. And as far as marketing goes, in gamma, release the Kraken, you know? Go crazy, you know? That's when you're really sending prototypes out. Jamie Stegmeier for Scythe sent out, you know, he did hundreds of blind play tests. And that did a great job, like, smoothing out the rough edges of the game, but it also marketed the game. All these people suddenly learned about Scythe, and it was amazing. I need to skip the next slide because I got to tell you the last thing. Ignacy Trevishek has three stages of playtesting, and there's some awesome stories. We just don't have time because I have to end on a positive thought. I have to give you a positive thought to end on. So here's my positive thought to all new game designers. Here it is. So people don't play ideas, they play games. And so many new designers overvalue their ideas. They're like, I have this great idea. I have this award-winning idea. No, there are no award-winning ideas. No, you know, do not overvalue your idea. This whole hour that we talked about was about the process of getting your idea into a game. And I didn't mention on the last slide, you know, 75 to 100 play tests of your game is about, to me, standard. That's about how many you need to get your game into shape. And that's at least, you know, you can do more and that won't hurt. So don't overvalue your idea. You know, you have to test that thing and play it over and over and over again. You know what happens when people overvalue their ideas? They start worrying that people are going to steal their idea. What if someone steals my idea? So no one's going to steal your idea. Why? Because the board game business is really hard. There's tight margins. All the work's still ahead of you. You know, all of the really big stuff is ahead of you, ahead of the idea. It's so much work to get an idea into a game. Nobody steals ideas. IP theft is rare. If it does happen in the board game world, it happens to published games that have already been reprinted, you know? And even that's rare. So please, as a new designer, don't ask your testers to sign NDAs. You're not doing yourself any favors. Also, related to this will be my last point, don't be too attached to your idea. Some tests are going to be really, really difficult and really hard. Like, there's going to be some brutal feedback. We're going to mutilate your baby, you know? And somebody might say, how's your test? And you might be tempted to say, oh, it was a bad playtest. No, that was not a bad playtest. That was a really good playtest. It was a hard playtest. It was a difficult playtest. But you're going to look back for months from now, and that was one of the most critical playtests your game's had. So bad playtests aren't what you think they are. And that's all part of getting from your idea to your game. And I'm going to end on this note. Thank you so much, everyone. Hope this helped. Yep. Sorry? Gil Hova, one word. GILHOVA. Sorry?
Can you go back
one slide? Sure. Yes. I can talk about this afterwards. I'll talk about Ignacy's three stages of playtesting. They're really, really good.